Welcome back to the Sports Mag Zone. Head coach of Anguilla's women's football team, Akilah Molon, is being accused of abusing some of the players under her charge. Some parents have taken exception to the conduct of the coach, with calls growing for her to be stripped of all responsibilities for the national team. One concerned parent reached out to Sportsmax this week, asking us to highlight what they say is the unprofessional way in which Molon discharges her duties. Among the allegations against the 36-year-old is that during a CONCACAF Women's Under-20 qualifier between Anguilla and the Bahamas on September 16 last year, she publicly chastised the 17-year-old forward, Carlia Johnson. Molon's conduct that day was described by onlookers as unsavory. Now, the Speaker of the House of Representatives in Anguilla, Barbara Webster Bourne, has taken an interest in the matter. During a recent sitting of the House, the Speaker decried gender-based violence in football, a statement many saw as a thinly veiled comment at reports about Molon's conduct.
As statistics show, 80% of violence is perpetrated against women right here in Anguilla. And these cases are growing. We see evidence now where women are abusing women. And women are abusing young girls, very young girls, especially in the area of sports in Anguilla, right here in our football association. And I want us to pay keen attention to this because this is growing. But we will get to that in another sitting. So I applaud you again, member for Valley South, for your fitting theme, End Violence Now. And know that I, Barbara Webster Bourne, Speaker of the Anguilla House, stand with you. And together we will fight this cause. We will end violence against women and our young children.
As the House Leader in Anguilla, now Molon, a former Trinidad and Tobago Women's International, was appointed on a long-term contract as Technical Director of Women's Football in Anguilla in November 2020. She's responsible for developing the women's game from the junior to the senior levels. Now, our efforts to get in touch with the Anguilla FA for comment have so far been unsuccessful. First, we spoke with a receptionist at the Anguilla FA's offices who declined to give us her name, but she did promise to pass on our request for a comment on the issue to the president of the FA, Gurdon Connor. Connor never called us, but we did place a call to his mobile phone. That call went unanswered. We then sent him a WhatsApp message. He has yet to respond to that message. We did speak with the mother of the player involved, but she says she needs more time to decide whether she will grant us an interview. As for Akilah Molon, we did place a call to her, at least two calls from my mobile phone, but she declined an invitation. Well, she didn't decline it. She didn't answer the two calls I placed to her phone to invite her to speak on the matter on this show. So this is where we are. We've seen articles about this issue. This issue has interest in Trinidad and Tobago, of course, because Akilah Molon is a former TNT international. And the issue also touches Anguilla, because Anguilla is where she's working now and where her alleged abusive conduct has been a problem. And so it is necessary for us to hear from the parties involved, find out what's going on.
Yeah, and you know, I really wish that all those calls that you were making earlier today, you got some sort of answer, and I'm hoping that this segment will cause them to respond, because that usually happens after some time. But George, abuse, and where women are being abused, me being a woman myself, I have zero tolerance for it. And just to hear that, you know, a fellow Trinidadian, we started the show talking about somebody, Dion Lendo, who may his soul rest in peace, is no more, and has flown the flag very high. Mm. You know, he has left his legacy, and when we talk about him, we'll remember him for good things. Akilah Molon, you know, these are allegations. We're yet to to really prove if these things happen. So we wouldn't say that she's done it. But just to see her painted in this light doesn't sit well with me at all. And I just remember recently when I was coming back to Jamaica, I was on the flight with Stern John. He's the assistant coach for the senior men's team. And I was thinking to myself, you know, it feels so good to know that my fellow trainees are, you know, leaving their marks even in different countries, because I know they love him there in Anguilla. So this this development with Akida Mulan is something that I know we're going to be tracking very closely. But for me, I have zero tolerance for abuse. And I just have a lot of questions for the parents. Why let it go on for so long? Mm. If this incident happened in last year, why is she still there? And is it true that she is getting the support? More questions than answers. Mm.
Yeah, you know what? We'd like to have more details on this story. That's the first thing I'd like to say. The next thing is that for it to have reached the level that it had reached in Anguilla does suggest that there's discomfort among the parents about Mulan's style as a coach. So that by itself tells you that there is, as far as the parents are concerned and onlookers, that Mulan has crossed the line. That's the perception of the parents. The world has changed a lot, Mariah and George, because coaches have different styles. You know, right, going through your early days up to your senior years as a competitive sports personality, you recognize that coaches have different styles. And coaches, there are coaches who are very rough and aggressive, and others who may be more coaxing in trying to get what they want. But if we're dealing with teenaged girls, I think people will be a lot more sensitive, even more than the boys, to how the girls are handled by a coach. And if a parent or more than one parent and the parliament in Anguilla is intervening in this, it means that there is discomfort. And whatever has happened with Mulan and her coaching style is not going down well with a lot of the fraternity in Anguilla. But short of getting all the details and more specifically...
Well, there are specifics, Lance.
Yeah, yes. Because Lance is talking about coaching style, and I'm thinking about an article I read in Y868 where they said about physical abuse,
yeah.
not only verbal.
So here's the thing. So, well, late before coming on this program, I've taken a strong interest in this story from when the email came to when we organized a segment with our producer, Ricardo Chambers, our senior producer, Ricardo Chambers, who has charge of putting us on the air and making us look good. And what is true, the fact of the House Speaker taking an interest suggests that there was substantive information for her to have gone that route, dealing with a story there. And people outside watching us may be saying, well, why does Sportsmax not have any of the parties involved on the record commenting on the issue, but feel it's sufficient to treat the story in the way that they are by mentioning it on the Zone and discussing it? Well, yes. Here's why. There was something shared with me just before coming on air concerning some determinations from a four-member committee that looked into the altercation between Coach Mulan and Carlia Johnson. The date of the publication of the findings of the committee is November 26, 2021. Oh. And the four signatories to the document, and I say signatories because their names are here plus their signatures, what purports to be their signatures, Mrs. Erica Edwards, who chaired the proceedings, Keith Stone Graves, and if I see my director trying to help me here, I can just show the signatures there. There's no harm in doing that. There are signatures on the paper. Good. So Erica Edwards, chairperson, Romari Kilsick, a member, Lowell Hodge, another member, and Keith Stone Greaves, a member. So four members, Erica Edwards chaired it. And if I may just go through some of the determinations quickly in the time we have, just to make it clear that there is more than a story here, and Lance spoke about specifics, Mariah, as well. Yeah. 17 determinations made. One, based on the oral and written evidence, the committee has made the following determinations. One, the incident between the coach and player is quite unfortunate. Two, the disciplinary committee found there was a complete breakdown in coach-player relations, which was played out in full view of the other members of the team. And there's a note to point to which says that that determination was hard to make given the fact that the committee was unsure about the consent of the tapings and permission granted to use same for the purpose. Yeah? Mm-hmm. Point three, there was a breakdown in the structure relative to reporting as the coach did not report the incident to her immediate supervisor. Supervisor. 4, adults were present when the incident occurred and did not address it, the committee found. Additionally, the manager, when made aware of the incident, did not address it, so there was some resolution. 5, the matter should have been addressed when it occurred or shortly thereafter in Curaçao. 6, some players gave one version in voice notes played for the committee and changed what occurred when they appeared before the disciplinary committee to give oral evidence. Now, in my experience dealing with matters like these, wearing another hat, that's par for the course where youngsters are concerned.
Yeah.
Adults will say something and stand by that, and especially because they would have been sought advice, mm-hmm. they said. But you find more often with the youngsters that they'll tell you one thing outside, when they're going forward to a tribunal, the story is likely to change. 7, determination 7. There is the expectation there will be professionalism, responsibility, and trust even under stress and the pressure of the sporting competition. 8, this is where it gets interesting now. The coach Malone used a confrontational approach in dealing with a problem with a player. 9, the coach made inappropriate comments in the locker room in front of the other players when she mentioned that the player's university coach indicated that the scholarship would be revoked. This action humiliated the player, the committee found. 10, there is disrespect for the hierarchy in the Anguilla Football Association in relation to the coach. 11, the coach breached Anguilla Football Association policy guidelines by holding meetings with the player without the manager present. Can't do that, yeah? 12, the coach refused to apologize to the team for her confrontation with a player and did not take responsibility for her contribution in the incident. 13, in respect to the player is expected to follow rules and be a team player with a positive attitude. 14, the player did not follow the game plan as instructed. 15, the player acknowledged possibility being rude to the coach. In bracket, they have stroopsing of teeth, that kind of thing. 16, the player attempted to apologize to the coach, but the coach refused the apology. 17, the Anguilla Football Association failed to make proper arrangements, in brackets, requisite number of adults in quarantine to monitor players, close brackets, relative to the quarantine when the coach was suspended, thus allowing allegations of smoking and drinking of players. So, you know what I like about these 17 determinations? It is showing that the coach was culpable for certain things, but that the players also, by virtue of their conduct, didn't help the situation, and that in the direct instance of the exchange between the player and the coach acted out of turn and unprofessionally and was at fault for her actions, mm-hmm. but equally, the player didn't help the situation by how the player reacted, mm-hmm. and then they said that the player attempted to apologize, but the coach didn't accept the apology. Yeah. I want to hear you on that before I finish up.
Yeah. That committee was what?
It's a four-member committee that looked into the issue. Mm-hmm. Yeah? Yeah? Let me finish up then. Mm-hmm. Decision. So those are the determinations.
Yes.
The 17 determinations by the four-member committee chaired by Mrs. Erica Edwards. Mm-hmm. And published on December 26, 2021. Decision now. Two decisions. Upon considering the evidence in the matter, the committee has come to the following decisions. 1, the player, Ms. Carlia Johnson, is suspended for one match. She shall apologize verbally or in writing to the coach and the team. 2, Ms. Akila Molon, the coach, is suspended for 21 days exclusive of the 7-day suspension. So what I gather from this is that she had been provisionally suspended for 7 days.
Yeah, for them to do this. Yes, yeah.
So 21 days, so 21 more. And she shall apologize verbally in writing to Ms. Johnson and the team. So both of them required to apologize in writing to each other. And of course, verbally and the team. And then 6 recommendations, 6 short recommendations. 1, the player should be provided with some training relative to attitudes, behavior, respect, and consequences for a breach of Anguilla Football Association rules relative to these actions. 2, the coaches need to be trained in dealing with players relative to their ages, sex, and other factors. 3, all adults traveling should understand their responsibilities when traveling with a team. 4, the managers need to be made aware of their roles and responsibilities while traveling with teams and their powers should be enforced. 5, the coach needs to understand hierarchy and her role within the organization. And 6, the AFA should ensure that at all times, the welfare of the players are their top priority. Now, here's the problem, though. I believe that the reason this story has gotten fresh legs in January, 2 months, well, almost 2 months after this this was this publication of the disciplinary committee and these findings. They believe that justice has not been served. They believe that for what the coach did, it should be more than a 21-day suspension. She should have nothing to do with the team, and they believe that perhaps it is the committee and the FA have somehow gone soft, whether by colluding or otherwise, have gone soft in dealing with the matter, and they're raising public awareness around it because, in their mind, justice can only mean that Milan is no longer associated with the women's football program in Anguilla. That's what they want to happen, because for what is here, where action has been taken, they feel that she has been let down easy, and they feel that for the alleged crimes that she committed, she should be let down easy. That's my determination from this.
Yeah, I get that as well too, George, and I get the sense that it's not just this one incident. Based on the way how the parents are portraying her, it's as if, you know, she has this attitude that I feel like they are no longer willing to work with, and they're just saying she has to go. Basically, they're saying get rid of her.
Yeah, but the Anguilla FA has to make that decision.
Absolutely.
And they also feel that the FA are on her side. Well, I get that. They feel as if she has that support from them.
You know what? And I can feel for the members of this disciplinary committee, because here why. It can never be the duty or within the powers of the disciplinary committee to recommend a coach be sacked. That can't be their duty. No. They should just, they are independent finders of truth in a dispute. And they would say, well, gentle people, ladies and gentlemen, we have sought to independently find fact. These are the facts we have independently found. Now, whether or not action against Milan substantial to her being separated from her post, that's not for us. That's not within our remit. That's not in our gift.
Yes.
It is the responsibility and duty of the AFA to then make any such considerations. We've done our work by finding facts and apportioning blame where we think it ought to be apportioned. And I think the committee would say reasonably that their work has been completed, so over to the AFA, which is why we need to hear from them.
Yeah.
And which is why we need to hear from Akila Mulan.
Well, Keith Stonegraves is a long-standing journalist in Anguilla.
Yes, sir.
I've known him for decades, and a solid thinker. And I would respect the work that disciplinary committee has done. Although it was addressing that one specific incident,
sir,
that happened.
Because because that's what was brought before them.
Yes. And I'm saying Mariah is pointing out that there are other incidents that have triggered discomfort with her performance as the coach.
Yes.
Which the FA, as the governing body for the sport in the country, has to address.
Yes.
This is just one disciplinary matter.
Yes.
So her overall performance as the national coach has to be taken into consideration when they decide their next move, or where does she stand with her job.
And that is the thing about this situation, George. You said it before you went to Lance. We have to hear from the people involved. You know, it's okay to look at this and analyze and whatnot, but I want to hear what Akila Mulan has to say.
Yeah, correct. All right, so we're not going to let this one go. We have to hear from the parties involved, and we'll be trying our utmost to get Ms. Mulan and to get the AFA President, Gordon Connor, to speak to us about this troubling issue in Anguilla.